إسرائيل. I mentioned already a few times who the Banu Israel are. Often in Surah Al-Baqarah, they are synonymous to the Yahud. But Banu Israel are not only the Yahud. Some of the Nasara, some of the early Christians were also from Banu Israel. So it's not specifically just the Yahud, although most of the time, when the Quran is speaking of Banu Israel, they mean it means the Yahud, but it could also mean the Nasara as well. But when that's why there's this distinction. You have Banu Israel mentioned in the Quran, which usually most both of them, but then you have a distinction between Yahud and Nasara as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us more and more about who the Yahud were in the past, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his Sahaba are being told about them. And I mentioned why, because they are coming into contact with them in Medina. And most of these ayats, if not all, most of Surah Al-Baqarah, if not all of it, are revealed in Medina. So last week, we mentioned the verses where they said, we won't believe you, O Muhammad, because we have our own faith. So they said, we will believe in what we have, but we will not believe in what you have. قَالُوا نُؤْمِنُ بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْنَا وَيَكْفُرُونَ بِمَا وَرَاءَهُ. They said, we will believe what has been revealed to us, and they will deny that which has came after. And that is a claim they make. They will say, we believe in the Torah, we believe in Musa, but they immediately denied Isa, and they denied the Injil, right? The first people to deny Prophet Isa were the Yahud. This is why, in the Jewish tradition, Isa or Jesus is not considered a prophet. They don't believe anything about it. They don't believe that he's a Rasul. Nor do they have, of course, the extreme belief of the Nasara as well. Similarly, and they also denied Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is a verse that actually highlights this quite well in Surah An-Nisa, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ ازْدَادُوا كُفْرًا. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِمُوسَى. They disbelieved in Musa. ثُمَّ آمَنُوا, then they believed. How did they disbelieve in Musa and in the Torah? By worshipping the calf. So they were believers. They are saved from Fir'aun. But Allah calls them then, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. They disbelieved. When? بِعِبَادَةِ الْعِجْلِ. By worshipping the calf, right? So they disbelieved. ثُمَّ آمَنُوا. Then they believed by making the tawbah. They repented. ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا. Then they disbelieved again بِعِيسَى, when he was revealed. ثُمَّ ازْدَادُوا كُفْرًا بِمُحَمَّدٍ. And then they had more kufr on Muhammad. So the ayah goes, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ كَفَرُوا ثُمَّ ازْدَادُوا كُفْرًا. So they disbelieved in Prophet Isa. They also disbelieved in Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And what's this excuse? Their excuse is, listen, we are Yahud. We followed Musa. We followed the Torah. And Allah is now holding them account to what they said. So you claim you follow the Torah. If that's the case, Allah said, فَلِمَ تَقْتُلُونَ أَنْبِيَاءَ اللَّهِ. Why are you killing the messengers? Does it say in the Torah to kill the prophets? Is your book telling you to kill prophets because you killed Prophet Yahya? You tried to kill Prophet Isa alayhi salam. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was mentioning other things that they have done that goes against their beliefs. Even the week before, we mentioned some of those things. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is still mentioning more. And this is why Allah said, بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِيمَانُكُمْ. How evil is that which your supposed faith commands you? You're supposed to be followers of Prophet Musa. Look at all of the crimes you're doing. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it carries on. When Allah posed the question, we left it off last week when Allah said, if you were such good people and believers and you're holding fast to the Torah, then why did you kill all those messengers? فَلَمَا تَقْتُلُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ اللَّهِ مِنْ قَبْلِ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding them, don't you dare claim that you are followers of Prophet Musa. وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مُوسَى بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ. And it is indeed true that Musa brought you the clear signs. So even when you brought Musa, when Musa was sent to you, that you claim, Jazakallah khair akhi. When Musa was sent to you, you denied him. You didn't only deny him, you denied his signs. What are these clear signs? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-A'raf, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَا مُوسَى تِسْعَ آيَاتٍ. Allah gave Musa 9 signs. And the scholars, they say these were 9 specific signs, but they were more than that. Wallahi, if you go through the prophet's story of Prophet Musa, you can't imagine not believing him. Allah mentions that among his signs were, if you go back even to the time of Fir'aun, Well, the first one comes to mind. You know what? Let's make this quite interactive. Who can tell me one of the signs or the miracles of Prophet Musa? What comes to mind first? The splitting of the sea, right? And what device or thing was used to do that? His staff, right? Al-Asa. That was one of his first signs, Al-Asa. It's mentioned in the Quran quite often. One of the first things when Allah said to him, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينَكَ يَا مُوسَىٰ قَالَ هِيَ عَصَايَ. And the staff, the miracle of the staff is not only that it turned into a serpent. That's one of them. So, and it ate and destroyed the tricks of the sorcerers, right? That was one of his signs. Imagine seeing that and not believing. Anyone that has any good in him cannot see that and then walk away. They must believe. And that's exactly what happened to the sorcerers, right? They immediately believed. قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ رَبِّ مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ. We believe in the Lord of the worlds, in the Lord of Musa and Harun. They immediately believed. And they were killed for it. Fir'aun killed them. So the first sign was the staff. And the staff had miracles in itself. The turning into a serpent. Jazakallah khair. The splitting of the sea. And also, we mentioned another one, which was when he would, yes? No, we're still talking about the staff. There's another miraculous aspect of the staff. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, hit the staff on the stone. And the scholars say this was a stone they used to carry around. And whenever he hits the stone, then water would come out. Water would come out. إِدْرِ بِعَصَاكَ الْحَجَرِ فَانْفَلَقَ فَكَانَ كُلُّ فِلْقِ. No, that's the one of the splitting of the sea. فَانْبَجَسَتْ, it started pouring water. Or فَانْفَجَرَتْ in A'raf and Surah Al-Baqarah. So the staff turned into a snake or a serpent. It gave water to the thirsty Banu Israel and it split the sea. Of course, all of that with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you had the hand that he would put in his jayb and it would come out bright and white. And then you have the drought that happened to Fir'aun. بِنَقْسِمْ مِنَ السِّنِينَ, right? The sinun, the drought. Then you have the tufan. You have the tests that the people of Fir'aun went through, such as the river becoming blood, or the locust, and the frogs, and all the tests that they went through, and the signs. All of these were signs pointing towards Prophet Musa should be believed and followed. Specifically, that's all signs related to Fir'aun. After they are saved, they literally see the sea splitting open. They walk through it. Fir'aun is destroyed. Right after that, they came upon a people that were worshipping idols, and the Banu Israel that were saved from Fir'aun said to Musa, can we have some idols like they have idols? إِجْعَلَنَا إِلَهًا كَمَا لَهُمْ آلِهَا. Immediately, it didn't even take that long. And then he reprimands them and tells them, no, you can't do this, worship Allah alone. Then Musa goes to receive the Torah while he is gone, receiving the Torah, this is when they create the calf and they start worshipping it, right? So Allah is reminding them, don't you dare claim you are followers of Musa and Torah. وَلَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مُوسَى بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ. And indeed, verse 92, indeed, Musa came with to you with clear signs. And what did you do? ثُمَّ تَخَذْتُمُ الْعِجْلَ. And afterwards, you took the ijl, the calf. You took the ijl as what? As a god. But Allah doesn't even mention that. It's so disgusting that Allah doesn't want to mention it. And remember when you took the ijl as a false god. The crime of shirk is so heinous, so bad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't even want to mention his details. But the summa takhattub al-ijl ay ilahan. Wa antum dhalimun, while you were the wrongdoers. Wallahi, Allah is so merciful. Allah forgave him, right? And so we mentioned in earlier verses, Allah, after they did this, thumma afawna ankum min ba'di dhalik. Allah forgave them. But Allah is reminding them now to destroy their claim that they are followers of Musa. They are not. And they are holding fast to the Torah. They are not. Then Allah is mentioning another thing. وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَكُمْ. Don't you dare claim that you follow the Torah. Remember, when we took the covenant from you, Allah says to him, when we, Allah is referring to himself, took the covenant from you. وَرَفَعْنَا فَوْقَكُمُ الطُّورِ. And we hovered and held the mountain of Dur above you. We already mentioned this in a previous lesson, because Allah mentioned this first in earlier verses when Allah was telling us that Allah literally took the mountain of Dur and hovered it above the Banu Israel, and they were told to believe. Right? They actually saw that. And Allah is mentioning it here again to say, if you were followers of the Torah, that wouldn't have been necessary to begin with. And even when that was done, what did you do? وَرَفَعْنَا فَوْقَكُمُ الطُّورِ. And we held the mountain of Dur above you. And we said to you, خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ. Hold on to that which we have given you. The Torah. Hold on to that which we have given you. بِقُوَّة. With strength, with might, with certainty. Hold on to it. Don't let it go. This is also a command to us, by the way. But instead of the Torah, what are we supposed to hold fast to and hold strong to and not let go? The Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah is saying, خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, hold firmly to that which we have given you. Hold it firmly. And one of the things that we see today is people are not holding it firmly. They are not acting upon it. They're not calling to words it. They're not saying, if it's in the Quran, I don't care what you have to say. But this is when we have to be people that... Umar ibn al-Khattab has a beautiful statement. Umar ibn al-Khattab has a beautiful... He says, نَحْنُ قَوْمٌ أَعَزَّنَ اللَّهُ بِالْقُرْآنِ أَوْ بِالْكِتَابِ. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us izzah through the Qur'an. Our honor is through the Qur'an. You hold firm to the Qur'an. You follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will be the way the Sahaba were. People of izzah and dignity. And wallahi... The only reason the Ummah of Islam doesn't have the dignity that they had in the previous generations is because we left acting upon the Quran and the Sunnah. And that's what it is. What's the main difference, right? The more people leave off the Salah, the more people leave off the Masajid, the more people leave off learning of the Deen, the more people leave off learning about who Allah is and His rights, and the more people go away from the Deen, the only thing that gave you dignity to begin with was you following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Banu Israel refused to do that. And Allah is telling them, we told you, خُذُوا مَا آتِيْنَاكُمْ بِقُوَّةٍ. I want you to imagine this. You are being told this while the mountain is hovering above them, literally. Literally. They are about, they're probably thinking they're going to die. And whenever, right now, let's say something dangerous happens, you want to hold on to something, right? Imagine like an earthquake happened. Immediately you're going to hold on to something, right? We tend to do that. And whenever you're scared, they call it being in flight or fright mode, right? You want to hold on to something. You even clench yourself, right? There's a mountain hovering above them. They could die in an instant. What is Allah telling them to hold on to? Hold on to the Torah. That's what's going to save you. Hold on to the Torah. Follow the Prophet. That's what's going to save you. Allah is reminding them, what did you do when we said that to you? When they were told, خُذُوا مَا آتَيْنَاكُمْ, hold what has been given to you, the Torah, بِقُوَّةٍ, firmly and strongly, وَاسْمَعُوا, and listen. Not just listen. Listen involves listen and obey. What did they say? قَالُوا سَمِعْنَا. They said we will listen. وَعَصَيْنَا, and we will disobey. قَالُوا سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. What were they supposed to say? سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Now, the scholars of Tafsir, they discuss this verse, and they say, were they literally that bad that they said that out loud to the Prophet? Musa, سَمِعْنَا وَعَصَيْنَا. Or is it, سَمِعْنَا قَوْلَكْ وَعَصَيْنَاكَ بِأَفْعَالِنَا. Some say, they said we will obey, but their actions show they didn't. And that's the scholars that most of the Tafsirs go to. They say that even then, they promised, okay, we will be good now, we will start listening to you, they promised. But then after a while, they fell back into their habits. And Allah then says, وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الْعِجْلَ بِكُفْرِهِمْ وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ الْعِجْلِ. And the love of the calf that they were worshipping was poured into their hearts. They became people that loved shirk. May Allah protect us from that. بِكُفْرِهِمْ بِسَبَبِ كُفْرِهِمْ. Because of their rejection. As this implies that their love to do shirk was a punishment because of their rejection of Musa. And among the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes, people assume that the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always something physical, right? Allah sends angels to destroy or people get hurricanes or lightning. It's not always like that. The fact that Allah deprives from you the ability to repent, leaves you to sin, wallahi, that's one of the greatest punishments. May Allah protect us from it. So Allah is saying that because of your, and this is one tafsir by the way, that because of your kufr, أشربوا في قلوبهم العجل. The love of the عجل that they were worshipping was poured into their heart. And the word أشربوا is used, شربة, is to drink something. And it's almost like, have you ever seen a sponge? How it takes in the water. It's almost that they took in love of shirk like that. There's another interesting tafsir that Ibn Kathir mentions and others that Mufassirin as well, that the drinking here is literal. It's literal. Because what did Musa do? In Surah Al-Taha, you will see a man named Samiri was behind the whole thing. His name was Samiri. قالوا تعالى قال فما خطبك يا سامري قال بصرت ما لم يبصروا به. Like Allah mentions a man called Samiri in the Quran. Samiri was one of the person behind the fashioning and the making of the scarf that will be worshipped. And what he did was, it was Angel Jibril who was riding a horse. Wherever his horse would land, it would grow vegetation. And he saw that and he started collecting that, and then that plus the gold that they came with, he put it together and then he fashioned this thing and it would make a noise. And then he convinced everyone, هَذَا إِلَهُكُمْ وَإِلَهُ مُوسَى فَنَسِي. Musa is confused and gone. This is when Musa went to receive the Torah. He said, he forgot, this is your ilah, worship this. And many of the Bani Israel started worshipping. Harun, who was among them, tried to stop them, and many of the Bani Israel didn't, and many of them did. This is when Musa comes back, he gets really angry, he has a Torah with him, he starts getting angry at Harun. How could you let this happen? Didn't I tell you? Why, if they did this, why didn't you just come and follow me? And then Harun pleads with him and says, لا تأخذ بلحيتي ولا برأسي إني خشيت أن تقول فرقت بين بني إسرائيل ولم ترقب قولي. Harun says, listen, first of all, let my beard go. So it implied that he grabbed his beard. لا تأخذ بلحيتي ولا برأسي. Don't grab my head or my beard. And then, by the way, some of the scholars, they say, the sunnah of having a beard, you can see from this verse as well. لا تأخذ بلحيتي. Don't grab my beard. Prophets were not clean shaven. Right? And sunnah to have your beard, of course, to grow your beard. But لا بلحيتي ولا برأسي. And then he said, إني خشيت أن تقول فرقت بين إبراهيم. You know, I was worried that you would have said, if I just left the believers and let the Bani Israel that went to worship the calf, to let them be, I was afraid you would have said, you split the community apart, turn them into two groups. So the concept of coming together and staying together, Harun understood its importance. But we should only stay together upon truth. So Musa then says, فَمَا خَطْبُكَ يَا سَامِرِي. So what's your story, O Samiri? Why did you do this? And Samiri starts saying, بَصَرْتِ مَا لَمْ يَبْصُرُوا بِهِ فَقَبَطُوا قَبْطَةً مِنْ أَثَرِ رَسُولِ فَنَبَثْتُهَا وَكَذَلِكَ. He starts mentioning his reasons. So what did Musa do? Musa destroyed the idol. And then he burnt it. And he threw the ashes into the ocean. He threw the ashes into the ocean. And then, this is where the story comes back. وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الْعِجْلِ. And their hearts absorbed, right? Or this is one of the tafsir, and the main tafsir is that it was their hearts, they took in the love of the ijil. But this other tafsir that I'm telling you, they were made to drink that water. You know how he spread the ashes of the ijil? They were then all made to drink that water. And anyone who still loved shirk, who was still infatuated by that, who still wanted to, then they would, the signs would become apparent from them. Some say that they would turn into the same color as the ijil was. Now this is mentioned, this is one of the stories that Ibn Kathir mentions, and this is why the word shariba is used to drink something, that they physically drank it. Whether they physically drank it, or they metaphorically drank it by their heart being poured with the love of the ijil, may Allah protect us from it, Allah is reminding them, remember how you claimed, we believe in our book, we're not going to believe in your book, O Muhammad? You never even believed in your own book to begin with. Because you killed many prophets, it doesn't say that in the Torah. Musa brought you all these clear signs, you refused to follow him. You worshipped the ijil. This is what you people did, so don't you dare claim that you were true followers of the Torah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ say to them, O Muhammad, بِئْسَ مَا يَأْمُرُكُمْ بِهِ إِمَانُكُمْ. How evil and worst indeed it is that which your faith commands you. Is this the iman that you claim? When you said earlier, نؤمن بما أنزل علينا, we believe that which has been revealed to us. No, you don't. If you truly believed in what was revealed to you, to Musa alayhi salam, you would have followed Isa, you would have followed Prophet Muhammad, you wouldn't have fallen to shirk, you wouldn't have done any of these things. So this was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's answer to their claim. Muhammad, we don't need to follow you. We're just going to follow what we had before. And obviously, the other reason is, and we mentioned this before, it literally said in their books to follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they were expecting him, and they wanted to follow him, like I mentioned last week, that they used to say to them, to the Arabs, when the final prophet comes, watch out, we will all destroy. So they were waiting for a final prophet. And when he came, like Allah mentions, فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُ مَا عَرَفُوا بِهِ كَفَرُوا بِهِ. When that which what they knew and recognized came, they denied. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 94 starts describing the Yahud. And he tells the Prophet ﷺ, say to them, قُلْ, say to them, إِن كَانَتْ لَكُمُ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةِ. If you are the only people that the Akhirah belongs to, because the Yahud believed that the hereafter belongs to them. They are the only ones that are going to go to Jannah. They said, نَحْنُ أَبْنَاءُ اللَّهِ وَأَحِبَّاؤُهُ. We are the children of God and the only one that He loves. They said, لَنْ تَمَسَّنَا النَّارِ. Fire will not touch us. إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعَدُدَاتٍ, except for a few days. We will not be punished except for a few days. Who can tell me why they mentioned those few days? Why would they say the fire will not touch us except for a few days? They're counting the days they worshipped the Ijl. So yeah, fair enough. We were wrong in that. We will be punished for that. But after that, Jannah belongs to us. All right? And then Allah asked them a question. We mentioned this in earlier verses. When Allah said, قُلْ أَتَّخَدْتُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهَدًا. Say to them, O Muhammad, did you make a promise with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did you have a contract with Allah that you're not going to go to hellfire except for a few days? Right? And the whole idea, the whole concept, going to Jannah because of who you are. We are Banu Israel, we deserve Jannah. That has completely been destroyed. That idea has been completely refuted in the Quran, where Allah taught us how you go to Jannah. You don't go to Jannah because of ethnicity, because of family, because of who you're related to. Abu Lahab, who is he related to? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab. He's going to the hellfire, right? And Nuh, his son, when he asked him, Ya Bunay, irkab ma'ana, wa la takum ma'al kafirin. Right? Did he listen? He didn't. And then when Nuh pleads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, innahu, my son, he asked him. Allah tells him, innahu laysa min ahlik. He's not from your family. Innahu amal ghayru salih. Right? So it's not about family or who you're related to. And Allah tells us how you go to Jannah and how you go to hellfire. How do you go to Jannah? How do you go to hellfire? بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَةُ. Whoever is sinful and their sin surrounds them, encompasses them. How does your sin encompass you when you have no way out? When you die upon kufr or shirk. But as long as you're a muwahid, a believer, your sins cannot drown you. As long as you have la ilaha illallah in your heart, your sins will not fully encompass you so that you will never enter Jannah. There is a way out for you. The door is open as long as you have tawheed. But whoever dies with sin and with kufr, they go to hellfire. How do you go to Jannah? إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. You do righteous actions and you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter where you're from or who your family is or whether your father was a prophet or whatnot. They said, we are the children of God, whatever that means. They said, وَأَحِبَّاءُهُ, Allah loves us. They said, لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ. No one will enter Jannah. We'll get to that in the following weeks. وَقَالُوا لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ. They said, no one will enter Jannah. إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا أَوْ نَصَارًا. Except whoever is Yahud or from the Nasara. By the way, this doesn't mean that the Yahud and the Nasara believe that they both enter Jannah. The tafsir is, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ لَنْ يَدْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ إِلَّا مَنْ كَانَ هُودًا. The Yahud said the only people that will enter Jannah is the Yahud. The Nasara said the only people that will enter Jannah is the Nasara. Right? And they're both wrong. Who will enter Jannah? Those who have faith and have good deeds and follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, but since they're claiming this, Allah is saying, say to them, okay, you're claiming that you're going to Jannah? إِنْ كَانَ لَكُمُ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةِ. Say to them, if the home of the hereafter truly belongs to you specially, خَالِسَةً, specially for you, مِنْ دُونِ النَّاسِ, and not for the others of mankind. If that's the case, why are you still here? فَتَمَنَّوُ الْمَوْتِ. Wish for death. You're going to Jannah, right? فَتَمَنَّوُ الْمَوْتِ. Wish for death. إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you truly are telling the truth. So, إخواني في الله, what is this ayah referring to? This ayah, the scholars of tafsir, they say, it is referring to the conversation that happened between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Yahud, when they said, we will not follow you, when they claimed all these claims that they are Ahlul Jannah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called them to do a mubahala, what is known as a mubahala. What's a mubahala? As it's mentioned in Surah Al-Imran, the Prophet did a mubahala with the Nasara as well, with the Christians as well. The Christians from Najran, the Prophet did a mubahala with them as well. What is a mubahala? Mubahala is when you say so both parties are claiming they're upon the truth. For example, the Nasara were claiming that Isa was the son of Allah, wal-iyadu billah. The Muslims are claiming, which is true, that he's the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now, to truly find out who's upon the truth, there is a concept called mubahala, which is, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ, say to them, Allah says in the Quran, فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ, say to them, come, نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا وَأَبْنَاءَكُمْ وَنِسَاءَنَا وَنِسَاءَكُمْ وَأَنفُسَنَا وَأَنفُسَكُمْ. Call your children, your woman folk, yourselves. And we will call our children, our woman folk, and ourselves. We come together. ثُمَّ نَبْتَهِلْ. Then we do mubahala. فَنَجْعَلْ لَعْنَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَاذِبِينَ. And may the curse of Allah be upon the liars. So it is a place where you come together and you say, may the curse of Allah be upon us if we're wrong and if you're lying. And may the curse of Allah be among you and upon you if you're lying. So it's a heavy statement, especially coming from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, right? This is also mubahala. So the Yahud, and of course, if you're wrong, then this would be a cause of destruction and death for you, your family, and your people. So the Yahud know this, and deep down they know the Prophet is upon the truth. So they refuse to do it. They backed out. And this is when Allah is saying, say to them, if you truly believe the hereafter is yours alone, خالصةً, especially, in the Allah, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's yours alone, min duni nasi, without the rest of the people, fatamannaw al-maut, then wish for death. You shouldn't be afraid of a mubahala, right? In either case, you're going to Jannah. In kuntum sadiqin, if you are truthful. Another tafsir that some of the ulama mention is that it was more of a question posed to them of, listen, if you're so sure you're going to Jannah, then you shouldn't be afraid of death. And it was known that the Yahud were particularly afraid of death. Even their war tactics. The Arabs were people that, the Arabs, even the mushrikeen of the Arabs, although they loved to live as well, and they hated death, but they weren't as scared of it as the Yahud. And you can tell that from their culture, they were people that loved battle. And they would go out in battle and fight in the open field, but the Yahud, they would fight behind castle doors. And that was known for them. Allah mentioned that in Surah Al-Hashr as well, أَوْ مِنْ وَرَاءِ جُدُرْ. And they had forts, right? And this is how they used to even battle. And they used to avoid wherever they could as well. And they would only enter into battles they were sure they were going to win. So they were very calculated. So they were known for this kind of habit. And Allah talks about this, and Allah mentions this. So this is the question, wait, but you know you're going to, you believe you're going to Jannah, you shouldn't be scared of death. You should welcome it. Contrast that with the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who didn't fear death. Who didn't fear death. And the Muslim, there's nothing wrong with being scared of dying. Right? This is very natural. But there should be a part of you, there should be a part of you that also longs to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Longs to meet Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make dua. This is something you all have to kind of check in yourself sometimes. Do I have that? The Prophet said in the dua, O Allah, give me a shawq ila liqa'ik. Give me an eagerness to meet you. Give me, provide me with this. Washawq ila liqa'ik. And grant me the gift of seeing your beautiful face. So the Prophet saying, there's this eagerness to meet your Creator, Allah Almighty. And the Prophet said in a hadith, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه. Whoever wishes to meet Allah, Allah wishes to meet you. And in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, من كان يرجو لقاء الله فإن أجر الله لآت. Whoever hopes to meet Allah, then that day will come. So a part of you should have that, and the believer, that is a part of you that should have it. And at the same time, it makes sense that the person is not ready to go and death is something scary, the unknown, all of that, that's perfectly fine. But not to an extreme level, right? And because if it comes to an extreme level, then it becomes more a love for this dunya, a love for a world we know is coming to an end. And we know death is coming to us. La mahal, absolutely. Everyone is going to die. Kullu nafsin dha'iqatul maut. So prepare for it as much as you can. but also have in your heart a hope to meet the most merciful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those he showers his mercy with. So Allah asked them this question. Say to them, if you truly claim that you're the only people that are going to Jannah, then you should wish for death if you are truthful. And then Allah said, وَلَن يَتَمَنَّوهُ أَبَدًا. And they will never wish for it. They will never long for it. بِمَا قَدَّمَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ, for it is because of what their hands have sent before them, meaning for what they have done. They know how criminal they are. They knew how criminal they were. They knew how much they lied, how much they distorted the Torah, how much they lied about the Prophet, how much they knew that, so they were not willing to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're scared of death. Because they are not even fully convinced of their own lies. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِالظَّالِمِينَ, and Allah knows and is aware of the wrongdoers and the mushrikun. وَلَتَجِدَنَّهُمْ, and you will find them, O Muhammad, you will find them. أَحْرَصَ النَّاسِ عَلَى حَيَاءٍ, the greediest of mankind for life. The people that are they work the hardest for this life. They want to live the longest. It will be the Yahud. وَمِنَ الَّذِينَ أَشْرَكُوا, and they are even more greedier to live than the people that commit shirk. Why is this? The mushrikun, it's known that they didn't believe in hereafter. They didn't believe in hereafter, right? The Meccans, they didn't believe in hereafter. They were idol worshippers, but they didn't believe in hereafter. This is why when the Rasulullah told them there's going to be hereafter, they said, إِذَا بِتْنَا وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا أَإِنَّا لَمَبْعُثُونَ, if you become dust and bones, you will be resurrected. So they denied resurrection. They denied resurrection. So it makes sense that they want to live. This is the only thing they know, right? So it kind of makes sense if someone doesn't believe in hereafter, they want to live as long and as comfortable and as possible, and they are heavily invested in the dunya because for them there is no concept of akhirah. Don't we see that today? People that say, this is the only thing that exists, so they pour all their energy and all their heart in this world. The Muslim is semi-detached from this world. The Muslim is not fully involved in this world and is only thinking about amassing wealth and living here and that's it. Yes, you try your best, you live a good life, but this is the true believer, by the way. May Allah make us among those. Your mind is elsewhere. Some of the Salaf used to say, "Kunu abna al-akhirah," be the children of the hereafter. Think about it. You should be in thinking about hereafter. Thinking about where you're going to end up. Planning your home in Jannah. Sending money to your account for the hereafter. How do you do that? By giving sadaqah, right? Giving sadaqah. And this is why the mentality, think about this. If you're the kind of person when you give sadaqah, you feel like you lost money, you're involved in dunya. Because in the dunya, yes, you lost money. But if you're thinking about the hereafter, you're like, alhamdulillah, I put something in my bank. Right, I put something forward for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a mentality thing. When you take that money out and you put that in the bucket for the Jum'ah collection, or when you sign that form that's going to give money on a monthly basis, or you sponsor that orphan, if your mindset is, ooh, wallahi, I just lost a little bit, then you're involved in this world. But if you're like, alhamdulillah, I need to send more, I need to do more, then that's when you're in the right mindset. Allah is saying to the Yahud, listen, you actually believe in a Yawm al-Qiyamah. You should somehow long for it. But you love this world even more than the people that don't believe except in this world. وَلَتَجِدَنَّهُمْ أَحْرَصَ النَّاسِ عَلَى حَيَاةٍ, you will find them to be among the people that are the most, putting the most effort into a life. Allah said hayat and didn't say al-hayat. And there's a difference there. If you say, وَلَتَجِدَنَّهُمْ أَحْرَصَ النَّاسِ عَلَى الْحَيَاةِ, it would mean they are the people that put the most effort into making themselves a life that's worth living. But when you say hayat without the L, it means any type of life. They don't care as long as they're alive. Whether you live in humility and humiliation or in dignity, to them it doesn't matter as long as you're alive. And when you're that kind of person, and all you're worried about is your own self-preservation, you don't have principles outside of the self, you're just like, as long as I'm alive. So then, this is not the way of the Muslim. You want to live in izzah and dignity, and you want to die for something great, right? You want to die for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or die in service. You want to die in sujood. You want to die a day that you are fasting, that you're doing good, right? You have a sense of more than just this world, right? And this is how the Muslim is, but Allah is telling the Yahud, you're claiming to be Ahlul Jannah, yet you're scared of death. You claim to be Ahlul Jannah, yet you love this world more than those that don't believe in the hereafter. You're claiming to be Ahlul Jannah, and yet you're acting like this. يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ One of them would love. لَوْ يُعَمَّرُ أَلْفَ سَنَةِ If he was giving a lifespan of 1,000 years. If he could get 1,000 years, they would take it. وَمَا هُوَ بِمُزَحْزِحِهِ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ أَنْ يُعَمَّرُ And Allah says, every one of them wishes they could be given a life for 1,000 years, but even if they were given that, that would not save them from the hellfire. وَاللَّهُ بَصِيرٌ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ And Allah is watchful and the all-seer over what they do. These ayat, ikhwani fillah, they are basically describing the state of the Yahud. First of all, you deny the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then you claim the reason you're denying him is because you follow Prophet Musa. Then Allah proved that they never followed Musa to begin with. Then they claim that they were people that will go to Jannah and them alone. And then Allah said, if that's the case, then why are you so fearful of meeting your Lord? Why are you so fearful of death? Why are you more invested into living this life and this life alone than those that don't even believe in the hereafter? And then Allah said, even if you got 1,000 years, it doesn't matter. That will not save you from the punishment for the crimes you've committed, for your kufr, for your denial. And remember, Wallahu basir, Allah is the all-seer. Bima ya'malun, what they are doing. I'm going to conclude here. The following verses will speak about some of the crazy and stupid claims they made to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they had to wiggle out somehow. And they will start saying to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Wallahi, we would believe you. We would believe you, O Muhammad. Fair enough. You mentioned all this, we will believe you. But we have one problem. What's the problem? Jibril. He brings you the wahi, and we can't have that. Jibril is mushkila. He is, historically, he would bring punishments. We don't like him. Mikael, if he is bringing you the Quran, we will follow you. This is what they said. And then Allah said, قُلْ مَنْ كَانَ عَدُوٌ لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِكَالَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَدُوٌ لِلْكَافِرِينَ We will discuss next week, inshallah ta'ala, what was the reason of revelation, and why did they claim they hated Jibreel and loved Mikael, and inshallah ta'ala, we'll continue the conversation between the Yahud and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We'll conclude here. بارك الله فيكم هذا آخر دعوان الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.